Welcome to our cyber soiree, benefit voice recital and wine tasting. And this is taking place here at Riggersloch Wine Company and being streamed right to you. I'm Barbara Brown, and my husband Kevin Brown and I are the proprietors of Riggersloch Wine Company. Kevin is the winemaker for R&B Cellars. I'm assistant winemaker. I mentioned that this is a benefit concert. It is. We have highlighted the Food Bank of Contra Costa and Solano, which is one that we highlighted a few weeks ago when we did another marathon cyber event with many of the musicians who, under normal circumstances, perform here on Friday and Saturday nights, jazz musicians, pop and rock musicians. And we highlighted the Food Bank and raised a bunch of money. The Food Bank is really important right now. 97 cents out of every dollar goes to the food program and to feeding people, and many of those recipients are children in need. So especially in these times with loss of jobs and everything, this is a really important organization, and musicians performing today decided to highlight that food bank as well. So we hope that you donate to that. This is going to be a fun, beautiful afternoon of music with soprano Revital Schmerling and pianist Paul Cacano. Wonderful program they have for you. This concert is going to be in three musical segments. It's going to be music and then interspersed with a wine tasting event with Kevin and me, then more music, then wine tasting, then music. So the first section of music is going to be music by Albin Berg, then a wine tasting of the Rosé Method Champenoise and the 2017 Vivace Viognier. Then the second part of what we see in the program is going to feature music by Libby Larson. Then we'll do another wine tasting, and that's with two of R&B Cellars, Zinfandels, the Swingsville and the Zydeco. And then finally, we will end the program with the music of Henri Duparc and Claude Debussy. And I think without further ado, I am going to turn this over to the two wonderful musicians we have here today, soprano Revital Schmerling and pianist Paul Cacano.
Thank you, Barbara. I'm so excited that I'm here. Paul and I, this is a beautiful place. You cannot see it, but this is a beautiful afternoon. We can see San Francisco, we can see the island, and it's beautiful there. A little bit windy, but we are inside and it's really warm and nice here. So we're just going to start our first set. This is going to be three songs from seven early songs by Albin Berg. And I want to mention that Albin Berg composed those songs between 1905 to 1908, and it was after already he started learning composition with Arnold Schoenberg. So you can already start hearing this extended harmonies in that setting. That was before he switched to atonal music completely, but you can hear those extended harmonies. Also some influence from some French influence of old scale tones from Debussy. And it's really interesting that only 20 years after he published those songs in an orchestral setting, that means he waited this whole time to be prepared to write for a big orchestra. And it was after that he already published the opera Wozzeck and Lulu. So thinking about that, in 1928, I guess that those early songs, seven early songs, sounded really, really early. Another thing, interesting thing about this piece, is those seven songs are in symmetrical harmony setting. The first and the seventh song are in extended harmony. The second and the sixth are in kind of moderate extended harmony. The third and the fifth are traditional tonality. And the fourth piece is a miniature of a really, really small and intimate song called In Zimmer. In Rural. We're going to perform only those three beginning songs, moving from extended harmony to completely romantic, beautiful song. Those three songs. So let's just start and enjoy. And I want to remind you, this is a live performance. That means if you hear some noises, yes, that's because we have a winery here. People are ordering wine as we sing. So you will hear some glasses and we might gonna have some technical issues. So I offer, you have the wine there already, so you can, every time that you see a technical issue, just drink some wine and maybe it's gonna fix the whole thing. Okay, we'll just gonna start.
Thank you.
so much. We have guests here purchasing wine, and here in Berwick, that must be a pretty different experience for them. We're just going to move to the first wine tasting with Kevin and Barbara, to the rosé and the
Viognier. So, we hope you've been enjoying the beautiful music that's being created for you today. And it is very different than a number of the things that we've presented before. But that's a wonderful thing about music. It goes in so many directions and so many different types of inspiration. And you're listening to a wonderful interpretation of this music. So, hope you have been enjoying it. So, the first of the two wines, we're going to do our Méthode Champenoise, a rosé, which is a blend of Chardonnay and Pinot Noir. It's about 40% Pinot Noir, 60% Chardonnay. Strict Méthode Champenoise, which means it's made in the traditional Champagne method, so the second fermentation takes place in the bottle. The fun thing about these wines is that they're so fruit forward, both the Champagnes that we do, but yet they're bone dry. So while you get that sense of fruit, you're also, there's not the sweetness that you sometimes expect. So, anyway, hopefully some of you have your bottle in hand and have poured a little bit, so you can, a little salute to Revital and DePaul for the first set that you've enjoyed, and there's much more to come. So, anyway, salute.
Interesting. If you're interested in purchasing any of these wines, the link to the website is up there. You get a 20% discount with the code CYBER-20, just for today.
So the only thing that we would like to make a suggestion, by all means get the 20% off, but consider, if you will, taking the 20% that you just saved and going to the Contra Costa and Solana County Food Bank and donating that 20% to them. You will not have spent a dime more than you would have spent anyway, and you would have helped out a very worthy cause while you're enjoying some fabulous music. It's a pretty nice wine.
What would you pair with this?
Nothing. No, absolutely. I mean, it's one of those things that it's like the perfect brunch wine that you could sit and just enjoy. You could do it with eggs, you could do it with an Eggs Benedict if you want to go fancy, but if you just did scrambled eggs and some nice bacon and some toast, I would be all over this. Actually, we did wheat meal this morning with bananas, peaches, and blueberries.
We did not have the champagne.
We didn't have the champagne, but I should have. It was a mistake on my part. Anyway, the other thing that I was just doing is we have this wonderful artisanal cheese and soppressata cheese plate that our new caterer, Terry Duck Catering, is doing here at the winery. And it's fabulous with this. So a lot of lighter fare would be great matches, but even if you just had peanut butter and toast, it'd be great. It makes everything taste better. You're on.
All right, so the next wine we're going to taste is the 2017 Vivace Viognier. And I should add that all of our wines have musical labels. Most of them sport a treble clef, flying notes, and also musical names, and which is a reflection of who we are as musicians. So we have fun with that. The Viognier is, first of all, this is from the Lovett Vineyard in Lake County, which is right on the banks of Clear Lake. It's really a gorgeous, gorgeous vineyard. It has beautiful fruit. You get a lot of different varietals from that vineyard. And Viognier is a Rhone varietal, and this wine is 97% Viognier and 3% Roussan, also a Rhone varietal and also from Lovett Vineyard. This is aged in a combination of vessels, so two-year-old French oak, a two-year-old puncheon, which is like a double barrel.
It's a double barrel. It's the equivalent of what two barrels would be.
Right, and then
large form.
And then also a non-glow concrete vessel, and so I mean, the reason that we do this is really just to that we use different aging vessels is to add to the complexity of the wine. And they all do different things. And in particular, the concrete non-glow egg, and we call it an egg because that's the shape it's in, like this, and it's really quite
it's
big.
It's about 7.5 feet tall.
And
big egg.
The shape of it keeps the leaves in constant motion. And so that just adds more sort of body to the wine and
softness kind of expands mid palate.
So, but it also brings out minerality, which is a taste profile that we particularly love in our white wines and what we strive to bring out. So, let's taste it. Well, first of all, just smelling it, I get this sensation, it's crisp, it's bright, but then there's like floral aspect, like little soft petals.
There's definitely a floral component, but also something that's kind of signature of Viognier is young apricots and white peaches. So, and again, it's not that there's apricots or peaches in the wine. There isn't. We don't add them to the wine. It's just, these are things, that flavors that it makes you think of or that it reminds you of.
And then as it sort of kind of coalesces on the tongue, I even get some tropical, just subtle pineapple, mango, definitely kind of a teasing of Meyer lemon, and then this beautiful minerality and just a delightful crisp acidity. For those of you who are drinking with us, cheers.
And now you're going to get ready for your second set. And this is Libby Larson. And Rivitol is going to tell you all about it.
So we are back in this beautiful set that we're going to sing right now of Libby Larson. And I'm just going to say six words right now. It's not going to say something, maybe, but I'm going to explain. So first, divorce, behead, die, divorce, behead, die. This is the fate of all Henry VIII's six women. The first of them, Catherine Aragon, he divorced from her. Anne Boleyn, behead. Jane Seymour, she died after giving birth, and then we had again. Where am I? There in the Anne of Cleves. That he didn't really divorce her. They got married officially, but then he didn't want her, so they kind of changed her status to her sister. And then we had Catherine Howard, and we had. And Catherine Parr was the last one, and she outlived Henry VIII and also brought some peace to his family and household. So the next piece is about five songs about those five ladies and wives. And I cannot stress how I feel about this piece. It's so emotional to me. The first time I heard this piece was at a friend's recital, Emily Crawford. She sang it, and I was just amazed about this music. And you know, it's not really common that when you hear a modern piece that you are so, that you get this first impression that is so strong. Usually it takes time to get adapted to some modern music. This one, no, you hear it and you love it from the beginning. And what I love it is each movement is a different woman. So Libby Larson was just amazingly wrote each piece, and it sounds different. It sounds like a different lady, a different character. As a singer, you have this challenge to show it. So you need to show naivety or great anger or just, being devastated. And it's different characters. So hopefully I'm going to give justice to this piece and sing it as Libby Larson wanted it.
I must need more.
Oh! This piece is taking all your toll of these emotions, and it's pretty challenging. And I forgot to mention before that all the texts in this piece are taken from letters that those wives wrote to Henry VIII, and also the last words they had before they died. So this is an excerpt from those letters. You can find all those letters online if you want to read them. I read them. So it's really informative, and you can learn more about those characters. And Libby Larson, again, did such a great job portraying these characters in the songs. And now, for some red wines, we sure need it right now.
And now for something entirely different. So I hope you're enjoying this as much as we are. It's
tremendous.
I wanted to just say something about Rigger's Loft, which is tasting room and wine bar, and we reopened 2 weeks ago, opened Thursday through Sunday, out in the patio only. We were hoping, and are still, fingers crossed, hoping to open for next weekend, Thursday through Sunday, inside the tasting room as well, but we're hearing now from Governor Newsom that that may not be the case, so please just follow us along on Facebook. If you want to get our newsletter, if you would just write to info@rbsellers.com, I believe that's up on your the page there, and I will put you on the email blast, and you'll know when we, how we're open and when we're open.
The way that we're going to be successful doing this is by following the protocols. Wear the mask, wash your hands, hand sanitizing stations, social distancing, all of that's critically important to make sure that all the places that you love and want to frequent and have frequented in the past, you're going to get a chance to frequent again soon in the future. So please, think about it. You're not only protecting yourself, you're protecting other people
as
well.
And protecting the businesses.
And you're protecting the businesses that you love and like to patronize. So please, follow the protocols.
And we have a large patio where all of the tables are at least 10 feet apart. And inside we have, Rigger's Loft. We know also that the tables, we have big space. And so the tables are set at least 10 feet apart. And so we have all the protocol in place. So we will make and continue to make Rigger's Loft a safe zone. Now we're going to taste the 2014 Swingsville Zinfandel. Would you like to pour that?
Okay.
And this is from two vineyards. The Zinfandel is from the Delmarva Vineyard in Contra Costa, and the Petit Sirah is from the Lovett Vineyard, where the Viognier is from. And we're big believers in combining different vineyards and oftentimes appellations. We almost always blend Petit Sirah in with our Zins. They're a perfect marriage. Petit Sirah adds structure, color, a little bit more to the little bit more tannic backbone to Zinfandel. So we always do that a certain percent. But combining different appellations can be another fun way just to add complexity to the overall wine. So our aim is to make the best bottle of wine, not necessarily big components of single vineyard efforts, although there are beautiful examples of that all over. But a lot of times, a wine could do better to just play around a little bit. I don't mean to manipulate the wine anyway, but to be a little bit more experimental and bringing in different appellations. Or just bringing in more depth of flavors to the blend. We aged the Swingsville in a combination of French and American oak. Is it brand new? I actually don't know.
No, there's only a little bit of brand new in the Swingsville.
So it's a combination of 1 and 2 year old and a little bit of brand new French and American. And this particular, and it was only aged for 6 months, but then after 6 months, we took it out of those barrels and put them into neutral barrels, really just to allow it to mellow more, to allow a more fuller integration of the flavors. And rather than intensifying it, if we were to stay in the middle. So in the nose, I just get this big, robust aroma of fruit, and I'm hesitate to say jammy because it's not, but it's just an explosion of fruit. I get blackberries and black raspberries and cherries, and then just peppermint spice. And in this case, as we strive to do, the nose and the palate are in line with each other. So it's lots of fruit, blackberries, black raspberries, cherries. But in this case, it's kind of not stewed, but more like creamy cherries. There's just a softness to it. Definitely the pepper, the spice, and the hallmark of Zinfandel. We like it.
Clearly. One of the most fun things about being a winemaker and it's listening to the way other people describe wine, including my wife. So it's almost like the same way that you're trying to convey how you feel about a piece of music, that you're trying to somehow make this emotional connection with everybody about what you're experiencing. And that's also what's happening with a glass of wine. I know that seems a little bizarre. It's just a beverage. It should be a simpler thing than that, but it's not. It's more visceral than that, and because wine is artwork. It's just, it's a different medium. Instead of working in music or working in paints or working in clay or stone, you're working in fruit. And how it then presents itself and how you describe that to people is so much fun.
Well, but also it's very suggestive. So, I mean, unless you're like a level 3 sommelier, if you're like me, who's not, if someone says they taste such and such, yeah, I do. I definitely get that. I might not have teased that out had that not been a suggestion. But it's also very subjective. Everybody tastes something different and does something different to everyone's palate and to match up with food. And so it's just a fun thing to do. And that to pair with this wine, I would say barbecue, fare, ribs, pops out.
Hamburgers, pizza.
Yeah. Or like a spicy pasta dish.
Sure. Yeah. Sure. All of those would be great things. The thing you got to remember about wine is there's no right or wrong answers. There's only your answer, and your answer is the right answer. Go with what you like. Go with what you taste. If somebody says it's a wonderful bottle of wine and you don't think so, it's just not a wonderful bottle for you. If you think it's wonderful and nobody else does, it means it is a wonderful bottle for you. So. Trust your palate, trust yourself, because you know what you like. You know the books you like, you know the music you like. That should be your guiding compass, is your own personal feelings about it. So the second one we're going to do is we're going to then go a little to the east, a little to the north. We're going to do Napa Valley, and this is our Napa Valley's in the Zydeco Zinfandel. So Zydeco is a fun musical form, predominantly Cajun, very jazz-oriented, but a lot of rhythmic intensity to the style of music. And the fun part about this one is it's probably a good reflection of it. So this is way more of the blackberry, black raspberry, the dark berry kind of flavors, maybe Bing cherry. And then you have a lot of this kind of exotic spice that goes along with it, which is kind of fun. So we're going to apparently share. Much darker, much more brambly, this briary textural kind of component to this. And I know nobody's ever tried or tasted brambles or briars. At least we hope you have not, because it probably was not a pleasant experience if you did. But
unless you're Eeyore.
Unless you're you or your Brer Rabbit. But the idea being that you want to get the sense of that there is a level of focus and intensity that's kind of interesting. It's kind of very poignant and very pointed in terms of how it approaches, you know, that how the flavors approach your palate or maybe what it makes you think. So again, you know, you have two very different styles of Zinfandels, one softer, more cherries, more that kind of Montmorency pie cherry character, the other one being more that black raspberry, that intensity. And that's kind of what you're experiencing today in the music, in that there's these wonderful ebbs and flows of intensity of character and style. You know, when you're listening to those letters, and the ones that were sort of more endearing and softer, and then the ones that's like, my head's about to be cut off, there's not a lot of good that I see happening for me in the future, you know, brings us to this more intense, more pointed moment. Those are all great things to experience all that, and I thought Revital Paul did a wonderful job of conveying all of that across those six letters. That was a lot of fun. So now you're ready for the third set, and this is going to be some Debussy and
Henri Duparc.
And Henri Duparc. So you're going to have some other fun things to try to listen to, to consume. And Revital and Paul are going to tell you all about it.
Yes.
Here they are.
I'd like to say a few words about these pieces. If you haven't heard of Henri Duparc, you can be, it's not really any problem that you haven't heard of him, because very few people have. He only wrote 14 songs in his entire career, if you want to call it a musical career. He only wrote 14 songs, and he wrote them all between the ages of 20 and 37, and then he never wrote another note of music in his life. Like Debussy, he was born a little before Debussy, 1848, and he's just an exquisite composer. And it's very sad that he stopped writing, because apparently what happened with him is he had this mental condition where he was incredibly critical, or he had a too strong of a critical sense of his own music writing, and he just refused to publish anything after those 17 years and 14 songs that he wrote. You hear the piano parts in here, and I just wish he had written some piano music, but he hadn't. But I know you'll enjoy this piece, L'Invitation au Voyage, and you'll see the lyrics up there, I'm sure. Then we're going to move to, I'm going to play a couple of solo piano pieces by Debussy, and they're from two very different eras in his life. The first piece is going to be Passepied. It's from the Suite Bergamasque, which is the same set of pieces that has his most famous pieces, Clair de Lune. This one occurs right after Clair de Lune. And it's very unlike much you hear from Debussy later on in his career. And you'll see that contrast when I play his second piece. This was after many, many years of steeping himself in the poetry of the symbolists. And in fact, when he published these preludes, that I'm going to play one of, he didn't even write the title of the prelude. He wrote the number of the prelude, and then when you get to the end of the piece, that's where the title is. As if to say, well, I'm going to suggest what all of this is through the music, and then it'll all make sense at the end. So in this this prelude that I'm going to play, is called La Terrasse des Orients du Clair de Lune. He actually quotes his own Clair de Lune piece from 20 years, 30 years prior. And that translates to, is you can imagine yourself sitting in Paris, it's nighttime, you're in a cafe having coffee or wine, it's dark outside, and you're just watching the night go by. And these are his impressions of that. And then finally, Revital will join me for another final song called Coquetterie Posthume. It's another very early piece of Debussy's. He wrote that when he was 21 years old. So we'll start with Duparc, and here we go.
Thank you.
years now. 25, excuse me.
Thank you.
Well, we hope that you've enjoyed the second in our series of virtual concerts. And what I hope the point that you get from this is that while the world has changed a little bit and we're having to adapt to some different realities, it doesn't mean that you don't get to enjoy all the wonderful, passionate things about music and the arts that you've always expected and enjoyed in the past. So we do it in a slightly different way, but we still do it together. Whether you're sitting at home, whether you're sitting on the patio, however you're going to do it, it's all a wonderful way to be able to enjoy it. So thank you for coming and being a part of it. Kudos to Revital Schmerlin and Paul Caetano for a stunning performance. And because you can never have enough good white wine, especially bubbles,
to celebrate this. Thank you so much. Whoa! Thank you.
That was lovely.
Thank you.
I must say, I did it just for the wine. Just wait.
So please keep in mind that you still have an opportunity to make a donation to the Contra Costa Solano County Food Bank, which will, while you've enjoyed all of this, you're helping out your friends, you're helping out your neighbors in what is clearly a very unique and a very different time. So please think about that, give generously whatever you can to do that, and applaud the artists and what they brought to bear to help your afternoon be a more enjoyable one.
Awesome. Thank you,
everybody.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Well done.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Well,
enjoyed
that.
Just delay,
because we didn't like
anything.
Okay, what does that taste like? I have no idea.